If you've watched the previous videos in this series, you have heard me go through the various metabolic pathways represented on this diagram. In this video, I'm going to try to summarize what happens metabolically shortly after we eat a meal and the body's responses to an unfed or fasting state. In the normal fed state, carbohydrates will be ingested along with a meal. This will increase the concentration of glucose in the blood, which will induce the pancreas to release insulin. Tissues will take up glucose from the blood through glucose transporters and phosphorylate it to glucose-6-phosphate, thereby trapping the glucose inside the cell. The G6P can be used for multiple purposes. Insulin has the effect of upregulating glycolysis, so some G6P will be converted to pyruvate, which will be further oxidized in the citric acid cycle. Oxidative phosphorylation will also be active to produce ATP for the cell. I've put these processes in dashed lines because as the cell's ATP supply is replenished, glycolysis, the citric acid cycle, and oxidative phosphorylation will slow down. At the same time, some G6P will be stored in liver and muscle cells as glycogen for use at a later time. So insulin will promote both storage of glucose and oxidation of glucose, and this is not a contradiction. As an analogy, an employed person receiving a regular paycheck will spend some of the money they earn on immediate needs like food, rent, and clothing. That is like oxidizing glucose to make ATP. But hopefully the person is able to save some of their paycheck for future needs like buying a car or to have in case they lose their job. That is like storing glucose as glycogen. For the same reason, some of the acetyl-CoA that is made from pyruvate will not enter the citric acid cycle, but will be used to make fatty acids for storage as triacylglycerol. This is another form of storing energy for future needs. When blood glucose is high, biosynthetic pathways will also be favored. When the body has a lot of energy, it is a good time to make essential molecules such as membrane lipids, cholesterol, amino acids, nucleotides, and many other molecules. So the pentose phosphate pathway will be activated as a source of NADPH for biosynthesis and ribose 5-phosphate for nucleotides. As glucose is used for these purposes, its level in the blood will start to fall. As blood glucose drops, insulin will be cleared from the bloodstream. Because glucose is ordinarily the brain's preferred source of fuel, the body does not want blood glucose to fall below a level of about 4 to 5 millimolar. As this level is approached, the amount of the hormone glucagon in the blood will increase, and this will impact our metabolic pathways. Let's look at what happens in the liver first. The liver has responsibility for trying to maintain enough energy sources in the blood for the brain to continue to function. Because the brain prefers to use glucose as an energy source, the liver will try to prevent blood glucose from falling too low. The easiest way to do this, and liver's first main response as blood glucose falls, is to release G6P from glycogen, convert that to glucose, and export it into the bloodstream. This strategy will work as long as the glycogen stores exist in the liver. The typical liver stores enough glycogen to maintain blood glucose levels for about 16 to 24 hours at most. Now, if we assume an extended fasting situation with no new food intake, then after glycogen reserves are gone, most of the glucose in the blood will come from gluconeogenesis. At first, the starting material for gluconeogenesis comes from amino acids obtained from degradation of proteins. The largest store of extra protein in the body is in muscles. So, after 16 to 24 hours of fasting, most of the glucose used by the brain will have been made in the liver from amino acids derived from muscle and from whatever other molecules the liver has available for this purpose. Note that the hormone glucagon upregulates gluconeogenesis right from the moment blood glucose levels get low, but glycogen breakdown will happen more readily than gluconeogenesis at first. While the liver is producing glucose for export to the blood, it gets its own energy from fatty acids released from triacylglycerol storage. These fatty acids are broken down to acetyl-CoA by beta oxidation, and the acetyl-CoA enters the citric acid cycle to fuel ATP synthesis by oxidative phosphorylation. Some amino acids from protein degradation can also be used to make citric acid cycle intermediates. The body cannot continue to consume muscle proteins to provide energy to the brain forever, because nitrogen becomes depleted, and because some muscle protein is necessary for the body to live. As time passes, the liver will gradually increase its conversion of some acetyl-CoA to ketone bodies. These will be released into the bloodstream and can provide energy for the brain. Now, it takes time for lipid breakdown and ketone body synthesis to increase to their maximum rate, and for the brain's metabolism to switch over from mainly using glucose to mainly using ketone bodies for fuel. As a result, ketone bodies don't become the brain's main energy source until about 72 hours after the last meal. After that point, the brain will still use some glucose produced by gluconeogenesis, using glycerol as a starting material, but most of the brain's energy will come from ketone bodies. A typical person with a healthy starting weight has enough fat storage to last for 2 to 3 months of fasting. After that point, the body has no choice but to return to consuming protein to provide glucose for the brain, and that person is sadly nearing death by starvation. If we now turn away from the liver and consider most other tissues in the body, during an extended fast, they will take up available fuel sources from the bloodstream. All cells will take up glucose and convert it to G6P. Muscle cells can also release G6P from stored glycogen. The G6P will be oxidized in glycolysis and the citric acid cycle to produce ATP. As previously discussed, for a time, muscle cells will degrade proteins to produce amino acids for gluconeogenesis in the liver. Most tissues, but notably not the brain, will take up fatty acids from the bloodstream, break them down to acetyl-CoA, and use them for the citric acid cycle and oxidative phosphorylation. Most tissues, but most notably the brain, will take up ketone bodies released from the liver, convert them to acetyl-CoA, and use them to make ATP. In general, during an extended fast, metabolism will slow to try to conserve energy. In the next video, I'll give a brief overview of diabetes as it relates to pathways of energy metabolism.